Movies occasionally produce characters whose identities can be reduced to a memorable line. For example, the movie Terminator, some of you might have seen it. My youngest son doesn't like movies that were made in the 1900s, so it's not one that he's seen. But if you're familiar with the movie, you remember that in the movie, Arnold Schwarzenegger, who plays the lead role, had the line, "I'll be back." And that line has become an iconic phrase in our culture. It became a way of a shorthand way of referencing Arnold Schwarzenegger's character. He played a robot from the future sent back in time to accomplish a mission. And that phrase became a shorthand way of referring to his commitment to his mission and worked its way into our culture. In a similar way, in the Bible, God uses a shorthand way of summarizing Israel's character during their time in the wilderness. Instead of using a phrase like that one from the movie Terminator, God instead uses a pattern of behavior that defined Israel during that time. It's a pattern that revolves around the word grumbling or complaining. We want to take a few minutes this morning to consider Israel's time in the wilderness and that pattern of grumbling against God to see what it reveals to us about their relationship with God, about God's identity, and consequently, what insight it offers us into our own identities. And this is part of our movement through the history of humanity in the Bible. And we're doing that with the focus that's our theme for this year on bonding, of growing in our relationship with God and our relationships with one another. And Israel's time in the wilderness offers some insights into that first part of bonding, growing in our relationship with God. So let's take a moment and pray together before we look at Israel in the wilderness. Father, we are thankful that we can be here together as a family this morning. We are thankful that we have time to worship you, to be reminded of your goodness and of your sovereignty. We're thankful that we have a time as a family to be reminded of your love for us through Jesus and the chance through him that you've given us to be reunited with you. We are thankful for the Bible that you've given to us, in which you reveal yourself, in which you offer instruction for us. And we pray that with humility, with patience, we'll consider its contents and that we can receive guidance from you to grow into the people that you want us to be. Father, with humility, we ask all these things through Jesus. Amen. If you have your Bibles, open to Exodus chapter 2. We want to begin at the beginning of Israel's time in the wilderness. And the book of Exodus opens in a triumphant way. It might not seem triumphant initially, because when we open the book of Exodus, we are introduced to Abraham's family. If you remember, Abraham is the individual in Genesis 12 to whom God made promises that he would bless him, that he would bless his descendants after him, and that through them, God would bless the whole world. Now Abraham's family has grown into a nation, but Exodus opens with Abraham's family enslaved in Egypt. And it's a pretty serious situation. Exodus chapter 2, verse 23, Abraham's descendants, the Israelites, groaned because of their slavery and cried out for help. And their cry for rescue from slavery came to God. Here's the triumphant part. The next verse, verse 24, God heard their groaning and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. Now, it doesn't mean that God had forgotten. If we're reading through the Bible, and the Bible assumes the people who are studying it have read through it, it's a phrase that we have already seen a few times in the Bible, this idea of God remembering. We find it in Genesis 8 with Noah. We find it in Genesis 19, and we find it in Genesis 30 with Abraham and his family. It's times when God says that he remembered the people with whom he was interacting. And in those occasions, it was putting readers on notice that God was going to act for the benefit of those individuals. And Exodus opens with this dire situation for Abraham's family, but it lets the readers know God is about to act. And it does it in a way that references God's actions to save his people in previous narratives. And God's plan to rescue the Israelites from their slavery is going to follow a very clear pattern. In Exodus 6, we're put on notice about the purposes for God's rescue plan. It wasn't merely to bring them out of their slavery, but it was going to follow a very prescribed pattern. In Exodus 6, God talks to Moses about his intentions to deliver the Israelites. And he says in Exodus 6 and verse 5 that he has remembered his covenant. And so he's going to bring them out from under the burden of the Egyptians. He's going to deliver them from slavery. He's going to redeem them with an outstretched arm. He's going to take them to be his people and he'll be their God. But notice the next phrase in verse 7. He's going to do all these things in a way that are designed to cause Israel to know that he is the Lord their God. He was going to rescue them in a way that was intended by God to reveal to them his unique sovereignty, to reveal to them insights about his identity, about his purpose for them in the world. And God's efforts to reveal himself to Israel peaked when he brought them to Mount Sinai. In Exodus 19, the nation arrives at the mountain and God comes down in a very dramatic, invisible way onto the mountaintop and invites the nation to come to them, to come to him, so that he can enter into a covenant relationship with them. But notice Israel's response to God's invitation in Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20, verse 18. They've seen God come down on the mountain. They heard his invitation to come to him so he can enter into this unique and special relationship with them. And this was their response, verse 18 of Exodus 20. Now, when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled and stood far off and said to Moses, "You speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us, lest we die." The nation's response was to pull back from God, to stand away from him, to refuse the relationship that he was inviting them to enter into with him. And the nation's refusal revealed itself in a pattern of mistrust that characterized the nation moving forward. The reason they didn't want to come close to God at the base of Mount Sinai was they were afraid he would kill them. This is after he's rescued them. This is after he's brought them out of Egypt. This is after witnessing all of his divine actions on their behalf in faithfulness to his covenant with Abraham. Yet at this point, they do not trust him. They do not trust his announcements to do good to them. And there's a deep mistrust we find there that characterizes their relationship with God moving forward. We're going to mention a whole series of passages that within which we find Israel grumbling about God, grumbling against him and against Moses and Aaron, his appointed leaders. And these passages outline the nation's relationship with God. And as we work through these passages, and we'll do it very briefly, it's important that you recognize these passages in both Exodus and Numbers are the narrative sections of the Israelites journeying in the wilderness. There are big sections, for example, in Exodus 21 to the end of the chapter, or end of the book, chapter 40, in which they're camped at the mountain receiving the law and building the tabernacle. The Leviticus book outlines further legislation that God gave to the nation. And then when we get into Numbers 11 up through the middle of Numbers, they're journeying again. The journey narratives are defined by Israel's complaints against God. In Exodus 14, they have left Egypt. God has plagued the Israelites. He's brought them out from their slavery and they're at the border of the Red Sea. And their response at that scene as they see the Egyptian armies coming up behind them in verse 10 through 12 is to complain to God, to grumble against him that he had rescued them only for the purpose of killing them in the wilderness. After God brings them through the Red Sea that he parts and using then that part of the Red Sea to destroy the Egyptian armies, we get to Exodus chapter 15, verse 22 through verse 24. The people again grumble against God because there's no water. They're now at the place Marah where God turns bitter water into sweet water. Their complaint is, well, God is going to kill us by keeping us from having drinkable water. The next chapter, Exodus chapter 16, the people once again grumble against God. This time, they grumble because they don't have food. They're hungry, and they pine for the abundant food they claim to have had in Egypt. And in this scene, that God gives them manna, this miraculous food he would provide for them every day. Exodus chapter 17, a second time, the nation grumbles against God because of a lack of water. And this time, God brings water from a rock to slack their thirst. Now jump ahead to Numbers 11. From Exodus 18 all the way up through Numbers 10, we have the nation at Mount Sinai where they receive the law, they build the tabernacle, and then we have census at the beginning of Numbers. Numbers 11, the people are going to begin their journey from Mount Sinai to the Promised Land. And notice in Numbers 11, verse 1, the people complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortunes. That's the way they characterized their time in the wilderness with God leading and protecting and provisioning and providing for them. They didn't consider it a time of blessing and a unique opportunity to draw close to God. They characterized it as a time of misfortune. And notice what they complained about in particular in verse 4 and verse 5 and verse 6. The people said, "Oh, that we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt that cost nothing. The cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up and there's nothing at all but this manna to look at." The second generation of Israelites in Numbers 21 would make the same complaint, but they put it even more harshly. They said, there's nothing at all but this manna. We loathe this miserable food is what they said in Numbers 21 and verse 5. In Numbers 14, God has brought them to the borders of the Promised Land. Spies have gone across and checked out the land. They brought a report back to the people. The land is great. The land is fertile. The land is abundant, but we can't take it. And so in Numbers 14, 1 through 10, the people grumble about the land of Canaan, that God brought them there to kill them in the land at the hand of foreigners, to die by the sword. And so they make a plot to return to Egypt. In Numbers 16, there's a man named Korah who grumbles against Moses and Aaron, against God for the way that God dealt with the rebels who wanted to depose Moses and Aaron and return to Egypt. And God deals very harshly with Korah because of his rebellion. And so a little bit later in Numbers, in Numbers 16, verses 41 and 42, the people then complain about the way that God dealt with Korah. And that leads us into number 17. After God deals with the people's complaints, he reestablishes the authority of Moses and Aaron in a clear and dramatic way. And the people again grumble against God. They complain that it was God's purpose that he was plotting to kill them in the wilderness. And then we get to Numbers 20, the second generation of Israelites. And Numbers 20 mirrors the story we find in Exodus 15. The second generation of Israelites, their story in the wilderness begins in the same way the first generation of Israelites' story begins in the wilderness. The second generation in Numbers 21 through 13 complained that there was no water. And it's at this occasion that we have water coming from a rock for a second time. And they accuse God of trying to kill them. And this mirrors the story in Exodus 15. What we find in these passages is a pattern of grumbling against God that persisted from the first generation into the second generation. And as we think about this pattern that defines Israel during their time in the wilderness, we begin to see a few things that come from that pattern. In the first place, Israel's grumblings defined their relationship with God. God rescued them for the purpose of blessing them, of working with them as his chosen people, to lift them up in the eyes of the nations around them so they could function as his royal priesthood, his holy nation, drawing the world's attention to him in fulfillment to the promises to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. This is what God announced to them in Exodus 19, verse 5 and verse 6. But their response was to pull back from God and complain about everything that he was doing. And as a result, their complaints defined their relationship with God. For example, Numbers 14, verse 22, God, in response to the first generation's constant complaints, and when we get to Numbers 14, they're at the border of the Promised Land, and they're complaining about the report of the spies. And God says that he has had enough of their constant grumblings. He said, these 10 times you've complained, you've grumbled against me. And when it says 10 times, it's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. Rather, it's a Hebrew idiom that means so much. Like 1,000 times you've complained to me. 1,000 times you've grumbled against me. What God is saying is you have a pattern of complaining about everything that I'm doing. And those complaints shaped their relationship with God. It turned out to be a relationship different than the one God intended because they refused to enter into the relationship he invited them to join. We also find that during this time, their complaints reveal they preferred their oppressive slave masters in Egypt more than the freedom God offered them with him. As we went through the list of the passages in which they grumbled, did you notice how many times they compared their relationship with God to their experience in Egypt, favoring their experiences in Egypt? They said they had better food. They said they had a better life. And they even plotted in Numbers 14 to return to Egypt. They preferred slavery to cruel taskmasters more than their relationship with God. We find, too, that the mistrust that motivated the Israelites' complaints twisted their perspective. Go back to Numbers 11. In Numbers 11, if you remember in verse 1, the people complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortunes. That's how they characterized their time in the wilderness. And they complained in particular about the food. They talked about how they had fish for free in Egypt and how they had onions and leeks and melons and garlic and cucumbers. They said, in light of what we had there, all we have now is this manna to look at. But then there's an interesting comment in verse 7 of Numbers 11 about the manna they were complaining about. The same manna, the second generation described as worthless food that they loathed. The manna in Numbers 11 and verse 7 is described as being like coriander seed and its appearance like that of bdellium. Now, that word bdellium that's translated in English is a Hebrew word that's only used one other place in the Old Testament. It's used to describe the rich, abundant resources that were in the land of Eden in Genesis 2. The food that God is providing them is being characterized as Eden-like food. This rich blessing, this echo of Eden that God has given to them, they looked at and despised. They looked at and described as worthless. That's how twisted their mistrust shaped their perspective on what God was offering to them. But despite the nation's mistrust and constant complaints, God nevertheless remained faithful to them. He didn't abandon them. He stayed with them. He kept the promises that he made to them, the promises that he made to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. Moses, at the end of his life, in Deuteronomy chapter 29, verse 5, reminded them that during the 40 years of their wilderness wandering, that their clothing and their sandals never wore out. God had been faithful to them during all of that time. Yet God's enduring faithfulness did not exclude punishment for the hard-hearted Israelites who refused to enter into a relationship with him. But we find something interesting even in the punishments that God gave to them. Go to Numbers 14. Numbers 14, verse 2. The first generation who journeyed with God from Egypt to the border of the promised land, who had been constantly grumbling about him and about the things that he was doing, and now are plotting to return to Egypt. This is what they say after hearing the report of the spies. Numbers 14, verse 2. Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. So God gave them exactly what they asked for. The punishment was to give them what they requested. Numbers 14 and verse 28, as God is issuing his punishment, he says through Moses to tell the Israelites, as I live, declares the Lord, what you have said in my hearing, I will do to you. And he proceeded to announce, I'm going to let you die in the wilderness since that's what you want. You prefer that more than what I'm offering to you. God is faithful. His faithfulness was greater than the complaining Israelites. But he didn't let them prey upon his faithfulness. Now, as we think about this story of Israel's grumbling in the wilderness, on the one hand, as God commented to Moses in Exodus chapter 6, we find in these narratives God revealing his unique sovereign identity. That was his stated purpose in the way he was going to bring the Israelites out of Egypt. And it remains central to the narrative for readers today and throughout history. But Paul makes an observation in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1 through verse 11, that helps us see another layer of benefit for us from this material. He comments in that section of 1 Corinthians that all that material written about Israel has been written down for our instruction. We find in it insights into God's identity, insights into human behavior that are to instruct us in how we live our lives today. And so with that in mind, let's consider a few applications from this story of Israel's grumbling in the wilderness. And we're going to apply these to that first part of our theme of bonding. Remember, as we're thinking about bonding this year, we're talking about growing in our relationship with God and growing in our relationships with others. We want to focus on that first part, growing in our relationship with God. As we think about Israel's time in the wilderness, we find that they preferred slavery over God. And it remains true today. There is a tendency for all of us, for our world, to prefer slavery to our world more than freedom with God. We prefer our world's ways of thinking. We prefer our world's values. We prefer our world's practices more than things that God tells us, the things that accompany a relationship with him. And it's not hard to figure this out, because when we look at the things that God lays out in the Bible, it's not uncommon for people to look at those and go, that's really hard. That's unreasonable. That'll never work. Those are the responses, because at some level we have bought into and prefer the thinking and the practices and the values of our world more than the freedom that God offers to us. And it's freedom that he offers to us. It's the defining way that we find these things talked about in the New Testament. It's freedom to join a relationship with God. We find Paul talking about this in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 1. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. It's the defining character of the relationship that God offers to us through Jesus. But it's a freedom that's pictured in a somewhat surprising way. Go to Galatians 5. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. And talking about this freedom that he mentions in verse 1 of Galatians 5, he says, you were called to freedom, but this freedom, he said, is to express itself as we through love serve one another. Notice the contrast. Freedom and service, freedom and slavery. The freedom that God offers us to us through Jesus enables us to commit ourselves to serving the people around us. Now, for many people, that doesn't sound like freedom, but it's a freedom because it entails entrusting our well-being to God's sovereign care. But very often, people don't trust God's sovereign care and feel the need to protect themselves, fighting for what they perceive as the limited goods and resources of our world. And when we feel that we have to protect ourselves, when we feel that we have to secure our wealth and our station and our well-being, then we end up complaining and fighting amongst ourselves because we do not trust God to do those things for us. That's what resulted in Israel's complaints. They did not trust God. And when we don't trust God, the symptoms of mistrust are things like complaining and infighting. But a trusting relationship with God grants real security and real peace, because we entrust our well-being into his sovereign hands. We do not have to protect ourselves. We do not have to secure our own well-being in the present. We can entrust those things to God. Now, it might not always turn out like we want, but we understand there's a bigger picture than merely the present in which we live. There's a larger reality that God tells us to also trust in. And that larger reality, built on his sovereign identity and established through Jesus, talks about a future life after this life. And we entrust our well-being in that full picture to our sovereign God. There is real security and real peace in that relationship. But there's another thing we can learn about our relationship with God from Israel's story in the wilderness. God's faithfulness is greater than our unfaithfulness. We're going to struggle. It's not always easy to embrace the view of life that God calls people to embrace. It's hard sometimes not to be overwhelmed by the realities of our day-to-day world. And God understands that. And so he promises mercy towards those who work, even though imperfectly, to remain faithful to him. For example, consider two comments James makes in his book, in James 2 verse 13 and James 5 verse 11. James 2 verse 13, James writes, "Mercy triumphs over judgment." And then towards the end of the book, he mentions in James chapter 5 and verse 11, after reflecting on the story of Job, he says, in the story of Job, he sees the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. God desires the relationship, and he exercises an abundant compassion and mercy towards those who are working to be faithful to him, even though imperfectly. And we can put trust in that character of God, in his identity as love. And that further grounds that anchoring security and peace that he offers to us. The movie Terminator, as I mentioned, summarized Arnold Schwarzenegger's character in that phrase, "I'll be back." In the books of Exodus and Numbers, the Israelites' story is summarized through their grumbling. The question for us is, what will be the summary of our lives? Will we fall into that defining pattern of the Israelites in the wilderness? Will we be people who second guess God, who doubt him, who complain about his will and his ways, or will we be different? What will be the summary that defines our lives? Now, fortunately, God gives us a chance to change the summary. He offers us, because of his merciful, faithful character, an opportunity to change our behavior, to change our identity. Through Jesus, he gives us a chance to become somebody different and somebody in whose lives he works to further the change that we want to make. We have a chance to become new people through baptism, our symbolic death as we reenact Jesus' own death, burial, and resurrection. And when we're resurrected, then God gives to us a new identity, an identity based on Jesus' identity. It requires us to focus on Jesus, to try and live in ways that emulate his own thinking and his own practices. But we understand we do it imperfectly. And so God offers forgiveness through Jesus as often as we need it. This morning, if you need to make changes, if you need God's help in being the person that he wants you to be, I'd encourage you to make whatever changes you need to make. Or maybe you've not begun that relationship with God, the one that he calls all people into. Or maybe there's some other thing in your life for which you need God's help and you need the prayers and support of the church family here. Whatever it might be, you have a chance right now to come forward and let it be known as we stand together and sing.